I'm Tracy Hyder-Suffern. I have the pleasure of serving as the executive director here at the National Jazz Museum in Harlem. And I want to extend a very special thank you to all of you for coming out tonight for what is going to be a beautiful event. Thank you so much. We have a full house in the context of what a full house is as we continue to observe COVID restrictions. Back in the day, it was 80. These days, it's somewhere around 30. And almost every seat is filled. So thank you so much for being here. And we're going to have a good time tonight. I want to take a minute to share with you that one of the reasons I really enjoy my role here as executive director is because we do the kind of things that we're getting ready to do tonight. We work really hard to offer the kind of programming that you cannot get any place else, or you could get it, but mostly you don't. So we're really proud of that. And one of the reasons we can do that is because of support and generosity from people like you. So please remember to go to our website. We're at jmih.org and click the donate button and support us however you can. One of the silver linings of the pandemic is that we gave some real thought to how we were going to offer programming and reach our vision of making jazz accessible to everyone in the world. And part of that was making the decision to offer all of our programming for free. So that's what we now do. And so that happens because of kindness from people like you. So thank you. So it is my pleasure right now to introduce Larry Blumenfeld. Larry writes regularly about music and culture for the Wall Street Journal and the Daily Beast. His work has appeared in publications and websites, including The Village Voice, The New York Times, and Salon. His reporting and essays often focus on connections between the arts and issues of politics and social justice, especially in times of crisis. As a critic, he specializes in jazz and Afro-Latin music. He programs and hosts the Jazz and Social Justice series right here for the National Jazz Museum in Harlem. He's editor at large for Jazz Is magazine. He is jazz advisor for the Wells Fargo Jazz Series of Spoleto Festival USA, and he's the co-founder and curator of the Deer Isle Jazz Festival in Stonington, Maine. My favorite part of this introduction is that he lives in Brooklyn, which is just a stone's throw from me in Staten Island, and he travels to New Orleans whenever he can. I asked Larry what he wanted me to say about him aside from his introduction, and he said this. I wrote it down so I didn't get it wrong. He used to be bad, but they say he's better now. Please welcome Larry Blumenfeld.
Hi, good evening. That was far too much about me. This is a very special place. This, in case you didn't already notice, starting with Duke Ellington's white piano. But this is a place about not just music, but an idea and a culture that gives rise to that music and surrounds that music. And Tracy and Ryan and everyone else has been very generous to me in allowing me to do stuff. One of the things they've allowed me to do is, late 2016, I found myself concerned about a lot of things for certain reasons. And I knew that we were concerned about a lot of things, and I knew that the great musicians and artists that I knew had very specific concerns. So we created this series, Jazz and Social Justice, and different musicians come, we have music, we talk about specific areas of concern, be it immigration policy, be it environmentalism, be it racism, be it gender discrimination, and we really dig into those things. So this is the 19th one we've done. It's incredible. This is Setting New Standards, Jazz, Gender, and Equity. And the musician that, you know, came up with this with me was Terri Lyne Carrington, the great drummer, composer, producer. Please, go ahead. I don't want to say too much, but, you know, last year she was named an NEA Jazz Master. When she was 11, she got a scholarship to Berklee College of Music. In the decades in between, she's won a few Grammys. She's worked with a list far too long for me to say of household name musicians, but it includes Herbie Hancock and Wayne Shorter. In the spring of 2018, when we did this series, Terri Lyne did one of these with me, and she performed in this trio with pianist Chris Davis and electronics musician Val Janti, and it was kind of incredible. And Terri Lyne talked about ideas she had about transforming jazz culture through inclusivity. And she said the music will never reach its full potential until there's equity in terms of who's creating it. So 6 months, a year after that, that trio formed the core of Chris Davis's great band, Diatom Ribbons. If you haven't heard it, you can hear that band. 6 months after we did that event, Terri Lyne and Berklee College of Music announced the Institute of Jazz and Gender Justice, of which she's the founding artistic director. And now this mission of hers, this mission of jazz without patriarchy, has spilled out in a lot of ways, but especially three interwoven projects. This book, New Standards, 101 Lead Sheets by Women Composers, an album, New Standards, that presents some of that music in as reimagined. And right now, if you're in Detroit at the Carr Center, a multimedia installation about the history and background behind these ideas. For this conversation, we're also going to be joined by one of the composers whose work is in this book, pianist and composer Marta Sanchez, who moved to the US from Madrid a decade ago. And you shouldn't really quote yourself, but when I reviewed her wonderful last album, I said it's accessible and lovely, yet built on stark contrasts and rhythmic complexities. And we'll also be joined by Kiana Hutchinson, a musician, composer, and producer from Brooklyn, where I'm from. Though primarily known for her work as a professional guitarist, she's newly embarking on channeling her knowledge of guitar and production into a creative exploration of original composition. She's also one of the musicians involved in the Next Jazz Legacy program, which is a really wonderful and ambitious program, that an apprenticeship program for women and non-binary improvisers in jazz, led by Terri Lyne Carrington. So if you could please help me welcome Terri Lyne, Marta, and Kiana, and they can join me out here. Thank you. And what we're going to do is we're going to talk, we're going to listen to some of the music that's on this new album Terri Lyne put out. We're going to talk, we're going to listen to some other music, we're going to talk. Maybe the place to start, Terri Lyne, is this book that we see behind you. Why did we have a need for this book? What moment?
I think you already said it in your intro.
Well, but there's a story, isn't there?
I see what you're getting at. Okay, we started this institute in August of 2018, and we had an opening event, and I asked some of the students to play some tunes written by women, and they couldn't find any. They found Willow Weep for Me, and they couldn't really find a lot of others that was common language, common songs that everybody knew. So I don't remember what we did. I think maybe they played some original music too. But at the end of that event, I said this will be our first initiative to make a collection of jazz compositions written by women.
Right, and I remember you told me, I interviewed Terri a while back about these projects. I remember you told me that the publisher said, well, 100, that sounds really
ambitious. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, I hear that word a lot for some reason. that's ambitious. But yeah, they said, you don't have to, do that many. Are there even 100 women composers that to pull from? I was like, wow.
Is that why you gave them 101?
Yeah, no, that was just a mistake, actually.
Oh, okay.
I had too many, I didn't count right.
But if we back up a little bit, when I'm sure you had to do a certain amount of inspiring and lobbying with powers that be to create this really kind of revolutionary institute within the College of Music, how did you express to them what you needed to do, what we needed to do, and why we needed to do it?
Well, I think I started listening. I feel like you're asking almost, well, also, why did I start the Institute? And I started listening.
I am.
Yeah, I started listening more to what the young musicians, young women musicians at the, at Berklee were saying. And I started hearing stories that were basically stories that were making me angry. Mm-hmm. So, and I didn't understand myself why I didn't know about some of this stuff before. And I realized I'm just running around and just wasn't really totally available. So once I made myself more available to just go sit and talk to people, I realized, well, the first thing I could do is try to create a space where people, you know, can learn the music without feeling, you know, with being nurtured in a certain way, without feeling some of the extra burdens that women can face in jazz education and, of course, just in the music in general. You know, like not getting solos or just basically being overlooked, being invisible and those kinds of things in a space that where that wasn't tolerated. I think that that was the first, you know, idea of why I wanted to do that and have a space where it wasn't male dominated. So I decided I didn't want to populate the Institute more than 50% male, which quickly happened. Because the first thing people think is, oh, this is an institute for women. And that's not the case whatsoever. The idea is never to really silo women, you know, off to the side and have everybody plays together and that's it. Because it's much easier to not address the problem when you do that. So after the first semester or two, we had just as many young men trying to be in this institute. But what was great about that is that the young men that came to us wanted to see the same thing. You know, they wanted also not to have to perform any kind of like hyper-masculinity or jazz masculinity or mm-hmm. jazz bro culture. You know, they didn't want to have to do that either. So I realized, yeah, it puts a lot of pressure on the young men as well when they're in, you know, an environment that can, for a lot, because these are buzzwords, and I try not to actually use them, but I can't think of better words at the moment. But, you know, if they're not in a environment that feels toxic in any way, they feel more free and more possibilities can happen musically.
It's funny because you're touching on a bunch of different things. One is just the literal equity and opportunity, but then that hyper-masculine or just a certain attitude that pervades the music itself. I remember decades ago, I interviewed Cassandra Wilson, and she was talking about coming to New York and finding musicians. She put it bench pressing chord changes, and also she would ask certain questions about, well, why would you solo here? And certain male musicians would be like, why would you ask a question like that? I'm interested, Marta, you, as a musician who developed and came up in Madrid, in Spain, was the context for that, you know, did you encounter these sorts of things as a female instrumentalist?
Yes, I mean, I feel like every woman, I don't know, maybe the younger generations have a different experience. I feel like younger generations are a little bit different, like, you say that the male are looking for another environment, but I feel every woman like experimented that. I mean, I was basically the only woman in the jazz scene in Spain, the only woman. Mm-hmm. No, I mean, like a step for singers, you know. So yes, everything that is related to that, you know. Yeah.
And when you came here a decade ago, I mean, obviously you came here not just as a player, but you're a composer and a band leader, and you have a very specific idea about how you want the music shaped and presented. Did you find that there were barriers to making that happen because you were a woman?
Yes, I mean, subtle, no, like super evident, but yes. Like sometimes, you know, sometimes people dubbing something or saying something. Sometimes I don't even like realize. Sometimes I'm like, someone says something and then and another member of my band say, you know, she's saying that because you're a woman, no? Because otherwise he wouldn't say that if it was my band or something like that. And I'm just like, oh, you're right, you know, it makes sense. We are so used to it that we don't even realize sometimes. And yeah, it's not that super evident, but yeah, it happens.
Now, Kiana, this program that you're in, is part of its appeal a relief from those things? Or, yeah, can you talk about just what that offers and what you've encountered as you've tried to develop as a musician?
Yeah, I would say being part of the program has offered me insight and just support and really seeing myself as an artist and not allowing, you know, things like gender, race to define myself as an artist, though they in a way can if it's from a cultural standpoint. And yeah, I've encountered, you know, these experiences, definitely like being in, like, you know, you were saying, male dominated spaces within school, like at Berklee, and even like in church kind of settings, like sometimes I would play as a guest musician in churches, and you know, even in that the section, it's a male dominated. It can be like the rhythm section, and yeah, I had experiences, and I kind of would keep them to myself because I didn't know how to deal with it. And when you're a lot of times in male dominated spaces, there's not a lot of other female musicians you can maybe relate to or share those experiences with. So this part of this program has definitely helped me to relate more to female musicians and share experiences that we go through and how to overcome them.
For all of you, when you were dreaming of being a musician or beginning as a musician, did you have female mentors or examples, or were they male?
Most of mine were male for sure, starting with my dad and just, God, so many people. Jack DeJohnette became a mentor as well. And of course, Wayne Shorter became a huge mentor. I had women mentors, women that I looked up to, but not necessarily jazz musicians.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like Angela Davis, who's a good friend, but I met her in my early 20s, so, you know, even though we're friends, she in essence is a mentor in many ways as well. Bernice Johnson Regan, I know some of the members of Sweet Honey and the Rock are here, Louise and Carol, Louise Robinson and Carol Mailer. But yeah, Bernice, I think, was a mentor in a sense, too, when I was, because I think I met her when I was 18, and yeah, so I knew I had people in my life that I could talk to about the business and about just the things that I felt understood me. There were no women that played music. A few singers, you know, because everybody that I hung out with was at least a decade older than me. So even though they were more like friends, you know, they had a little more life experience. You know, Diane Reeves, Cassandra Wilson, people like that.
What about the two of you? Did you have, were there female musicians or in any way mentors that were examples for you?
Yeah, I didn't have any female mentors in terms of musicians. But, and male, like my teachers from high school who were male, they definitely inspired me to just keep going. And honestly, like, even I would say, in like looking back at my musical journey, so like I used to like go in the subway and just perform, like when I was in high school, just to make money. I have a little amp and guitar, and that's like how I practice a lot. Like I'll do that for hours, like every day after school. And I would meet musicians that way throughout New York. They would say, come sit in with my band, or, you know, like, can you do this gig? And that gave me a lot of confidence within myself and people that embraced me. Like, it was never anything about gender. It was like, you're a great guitar player. So, yeah, I kind of had mentors, people like that were my age and also older than me, just through that experience of putting myself out there. Didn't really have any, key mentors that I could, like, besides teachers, I would say.
Yeah, well, I unfortunately also, I don't have any male mentors. There are no, as I say, they weren't like musicians in Spain. They were female. Obviously there were like some musicians that I would look up, you know, but in records and there were no people that I had that experience with them. Also, it wasn't like, most of my mentors also, it wasn't like a great relations. I didn't realize at that moment because I thought that it was normal, but also most of them were hitting on me or were trying to have sex with me besides the music and everything, which is something that I found like normal back then, but now I realize it wasn't like, I don't know, it wasn't like people that maybe I felt so comfortable with me, maybe. I mean, I've always been like a fighter. I'm not like super sensitive to these things. It's like whatever, you know, but I guess, like, you know, that affects your relationship with music and everything. You know?
Yeah, I just want to say something about that because that's another reason that I started this institute, only because, you know, you start thinking about all the extra burdens that women face trying to play this music, which is not cool, right. You know? Right. I mean, that's just one, being hit on. It's like, as you said, like, that just kind of goes with it, you know, but it shouldn't.
Yeah.
But there's others, you know, other burdens, and even just jam session culture is not very, you know, has traditionally not been very welcoming to women instrumentalists. Also, not always safe because you have to get a ride home, or it's late, or you have to take the subway, or whatever, you know, it is. Mm-hmm. And the other thing I want to say about that is. I think I wasn't as sensitive to these things either because, like you, I let it roll off my back. It wasn't a big deal because I felt like I could protect myself.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, I never felt incredibly threatened.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, but I recognize that everybody's not like that. You know, so my attitude before, if young women had come to me and ask, you know, some of these questions, I'd be just toughen up, just do it, just go through, just plow through, just, you know, and that was because that's what I did. And that I realized that's not the best advice. I had one student that just quit, you know, because I was being, that's when I started thinking, oh, maybe I should.
Happened to me too, like here in New York, hearing like stories of people, and I almost quit music. That happened to me. I didn't want to play with any male after that. I realized that people is super sensitive and it can ruin your career and your dreams and everything, you know.
Right, and also you have the confidence. Everybody doesn't have the same confidence because they didn't have the same whatever upbringing. And also some of it's, I think, genetic. Because when I was 11 years old and I met Buddy Rich, I didn't have a problem speaking up and, you know, standing up to him.
Right.
And I didn't realize he was this monster of a guy that nobody spoke up to. You know what I mean? So it was just in my DNA, you know. And so it's not surprising. Like, so if somebody hit on me, you know, some, you know, very famous musicians, if they hit on me, I could just kind of laugh and, you know, do like that and not worry that they were going to fire me. It never crossed my mind that I would lose a gig. You know what I mean? And so when I hear so many young women saying, you know, they have to weigh, do I really want this musical experience and put up with this nonsense?
Right.
And then, you know, figuring out how much nonsense they want to put up with just to get the musical experience. That's when I realized, oh, wow, this has to change.
You know, obviously the kind of intimidation and even abuse that you are starting to talk about is wrong in any workplace or in any educational situation. But, you know, this place is about a history of a music that, if we know anything about it, it can't even happen without a certain amount of empathy and communication and trust between musicians, or else you're not really playing jazz. And you know that the stuff you're talking about would make it impossible to make the music, right? It intimidates the music itself, right?
Yeah. I mean, but what you're saying is interesting because you're saying you have to have a certain amount of trust and you have to have empathy and all that, but is that only for each other? You know what I mean? Like, this is, I said the other day, this is not men's music.
Right.
You know, maybe we should have that category.
You know,
you know what I'm saying? Maybe we should have a category called men's music.
Well, you know,
so they can all go there and just do that with themselves.
Right, right.
And then we can all play and have jazz.
I remember there used to be Mary Lou Williams Women in Jazz Festival, and I was like, well, there's not really like a John Coltrane Men in Jazz Festival. It seems, and now it isn't called that. So, Terri Lyne, you created this book, which partly is to say, hey, there is a book of music, jazz written by female composers that you can have and work with and play on gigs, but also just to the evidence that this body of work exists. And then New Standards Volume 1, terrific recording, the new recording, is Volume 1, the first example of a group of women and men playing this music. So we're going to do that terrible thing where we only play parts of tracks. But you can get the album and hear the whole track. So could we, I remember when I asked you, well, the album starts with Windflower, composed by Sarah Cassie. So could we hear a little bit of that?
You want to say something about Sarah?
Let's hear it first. Let's hear it first. And then I want you to tell us a little bit about who created this music. I have to confess, I didn't know Sarah Cassie's name, and then I realized there's an interesting story there. So what can you tell us about the discovery of her and her who she was?
Well, I don't know what your interesting story is. Maybe you did some other research, but basically for me, as I was looking for music and I was communicating with Don Sickler to get Melba Liston's song, because he administers her publishing, he said, do you know about Sarah Cassie? And I said, no. And he said, well, before Jerry passed away, Jerry Allen, she was very interested in Sarah's work, and Sarah's from Detroit. But she died, I forget the year. Do you have it written? Okay, you might have. Yeah, maybe in the 60s. But she was she worked at a publishing house here in New York, and I think she worked there in an administrative position and then also composed. I think she did both. and I don't remember the name of the publishing house, but people started recording her music, Herb Ellis, Hank Jones, Ron Carter, Johnny Griffin, different people started recording her music, but she died very young. I think she was in her 30s.
66.
Yeah.
She died in 66, and yeah, maybe. She was 37, yeah. Yeah, yeah, no, yeah. What I, what, and you were the person who, you know, pointed me in that direction. What I thought was really interesting. Well, first of all, that anyone Jerry Allen is interested in is interesting, but also, you know, she wasn't a performing musician,
right?
And yet she quietly composed this music that a whole lot of heavy musicians seem to want to play on gigs and record. Mm-hmm. So that, you know.
Yeah, Ron Carter, I think, was the one that told me she did composed pieces, too. So I think her background may have been in classical music.
Now, the process of doing the book, did you, for instance, there's Marta's piece, Unchained. Did you ask people to contribute pieces, or did you? How did you go about doing this?
Well, it's sort of different with different people. Like, for instance, you know, Maria Schneider or Carla Belay, who have songs in the book, I just, anything they wanted to send me, you know, I would take. And they sent, like, one song, and I was like, that's great, that's perfect. Mm-hmm. Some people sent several songs. Some people I asked for several songs to choose one. Some people I had played with, and there was already a song in my head that I wanted from that person because I liked it because I played it with them. So it was kind of different with each person.
And can we hear a little bit of Unchanged, and then maybe Marta, if you want to say something about that. Can we hear a little bit of Unchanged, which was composed by Marta Sanchez?
Thank you.
regard to, I don't know if there's anything in particular you do or don't want to say about that piece, but yeah, is there anything that?
No, I mean, it's a piece that is like not in my last album, but in the previous one.
Yes.
I just, I think probably Terri, you contacted me because Chris talked. I know Chris Davis for a while, so I guess he talked about me. And I just chose this piece because I always write for all my last composition. I've been writing for my quintet for a long time, and they are all like a lot of lines. Every instrument has its own melody and the bass, and it was really hard to do a sit, you know, at least sit for a standard folk. So that song was the simplest one, the one that I could reduce to a lead sit. And still when they recorded, like Terri had to call me, can you give me like the line of the guitar? Can you give me the piano part? It's not there.
Yeah. I mean, because the one thing that I asked all the composers was to have one or two page lead sheets, so that it really did feel like lead sheets and not
right.
like 5-6 pages of music for one song. Mm-hmm. So that was the stipulation. So people had to look accordingly.
No, and one thing I love about the book, it's also broken up into sections of different kind, and it isn't just, it is a political statement and a consciousness raiser, but it's also just a practical tool for working and learning musicians that a developing musician could learn from and a very, you know, a highly advanced professional could use. And that's what it should be. Now, Marta, you know, if I'm writing about you or someone is writing about you in the New York Times, which we are doing, and we're hopefully putting you in the story of this moment in time, but does it hold, how does it hold any special meaning for you to have your piece in this book and put in that context?
Yeah, of course.
What's she gonna say?
Nobody does. Uh-oh.
Well,
I mean, I'm already embarrassed. Now we're like embarrassing all of us.
That's my job. it's kind of my job. I'm glad I'm doing it so well. Well, I guess something I'm getting at is, I guess when I was learning about jazz and when I was writing about jazz, it took me a while to realize that I knew who Mary Lou Williams was. I knew who Alice Coltrane was. I knew who Lil Hardin Armstrong was, but I didn't really know who they were and what their real stories and roles were. I felt like I had been denied, maybe intentionally, certain history and context. Did you?
I actually want to answer the question.
All right. See, it wasn't.
Yeah, that is special for me because I feel like it's some. Nobody really addressed that like it's mostly male, and I think things wouldn't have, I mean, they were changing a little bit, but if like a lot of kids, there is like a study that said that a lot of women, a lot of like girls start studying jazz, and most of them drop by, you know, about a certain age, 11, 14, 15, I don't know, you know, because they don't have role models, because they don't have, you know, life, things like that. And I feel like Terri and the people at the Berklee Institute are doing, you know, because a lot of people talk about that and whatever, but you guys are doing things that actually they are gonna make a change, like material that people can use to actually play, you know, like having this mentorship program that is allowing like this woman to play with like some of the idols, no, like the musicians, things like that, like practical things that actually I feel like in a few years are really gonna change the scene, you know, because like these girls are not gonna drop off the jazz school because they are, you know, the environment is gonna be different and they're gonna have mentors and et cetera. And be part of that, I think, is really special, and it's special for Ria, you know, because there is, yeah.
See, it wasn't such a bad question like, after all. No, but I do, I'm interested in what any of you think about, do you feel like, because I know even if we were to walk around this neighborhood now, there's certain history and context that's been erased. Some of it maybe just fell away, some of it quite intentionally. Do you, as you learned and developed, do you feel like there's there's a history of women composers, musicians, figures in the history of this music that whose stories you were denied?
I can't really truly say I was denied it. I had the privilege of the internet when I was growing up. There's people like older than me, mentor type figures. They saw me as a young woman trying to learn jazz and guitar, so they would hit me to people like Emily Remler. I would go check that out on YouTube. There's other women musicians that people would share with me and that I discovered. When I think about it, like in the institutional way, in classes, we didn't really discuss women musicians as much as we did male musicians. So maybe in that sense, there was some just lack of representation, and in that way, maybe I was denied.
I think what you bring up a great point about classrooms and what's denied in classrooms, which I'll comment on as well. But I think the denial part comes from, not knowing who the other people are. So there's always the few that get through. So you said Emily Remler, of course, but how many other, Emily Remlers were there that we don't know because they quit early or because so I think we are actually denied in a larger sense. And the problem with, myself, Esperanza, and people that, have had decent careers since we were young, is the problem of exceptions, because it's people say, well, we have Mary Lou Williams, or well, we have Jerry Allen, or we have Terri Lyne Esperanza, and it's setting up a thing where it's okay to have these exceptions, and it's not setting up. Just like the study that Lara Pellegrinelli did recently for NPR, and everybody can brag that in the top 10 of the critics' polls for that platform, there was more gender balance than ever. I don't remember the exact number, but there was more than ever. But then if you looked at the top 100, it wasn't representing the same way. So there's only, gender equity, would have to be pervasive throughout, all of the rankings. Because if not, then you're dealing with the exceptionalism again. So we have Mary Halverson, and we have, they're all in the top 10, Chris Davis. And then when you look at the rest of the 90, there's maybe a couple of women floating around.
Right.
So there's all of these things, data and all that depends on how you look at it. And as far as education, jazz history, period, is really poor in most programs, right? They do the history of jazz in one semester, which is very difficult to do. And it doesn't, necessarily also reflect Black music in general, which the connections have to be made between jazz and Black music, because if you just teach it like it's in a museum, because we're in a museum, but if you just teach it like it's in a museum, it also makes it old and a relic or something. So, there's so much cultural, contextualization that has to happen to really make it actually accurate. And let's not then talk about like the women's representation and all that. You may get a mention of Mary Lou Williams, but I bet even less than Mary Lou get a mention of Lil Hardin Armstrong. And without her, you could say that Louis Armstrong wouldn't have been Louis Armstrong. She was ghostwriting for him. She was giving him advice. She's the one that told him to leave King Oliver and only play the lead. And she said she wasn't going to marry him if he didn't become a leader. There's like a lot of history that people don't know. And she's, and that's not the only example.
I mean, you you mentioned Jerry Allen, you know, who we all miss a lot, and who, you know, I would say on my watch in my career, in the period of time I was documenting, was one of the giants who really transformed a period of time. But also Jerry, who was a good scholar, yeah, she could expound all about, not in addition to what you said about Lil' Horn Armstrong, what Lil' Horn Armstrong did with her left hand and what was significant about that. And, you know, unfortunately we were robbed of this, not only this musician, but this carrier of history. But since you mentioned you, Jerry, and Esperanza, the great trio that the three of you formed that I would have wanted to continue hearing for years and years, and who is documented in a children's book that you've created that we have out in the front. You know, I remember I heard that group and I wrote something like, the least remarkable thing about this trio is that it's three female instrumentalists. But because it was just, you know, this is really exciting and new, I want to see where this spaceship goes. But was there something about the fact that you were three female instrumentalists who all had an interest in shaking off that patriarchy?
All had an interest, you said interest in?
Interest in shaking off that patriarchy. You know.
Yeah, I think, it formed from the first time we all played together. It was a quartet I had brought to Israel for the Red Sea Jazz Festival. And it was Jerry Nesperance and myself, as well as Tineke Postma from Holland. And then when something happened, like at that gig, I said, wow, this feels... Well, the first thing was I called three other women just because I liked the way they played. And I didn't realize that I called three other women until it was all set in stone. You know what I mean? It wasn't like I wasn't trying to call women. And then when we played together, it felt very special. That's when I decided to do this album, The Mosaic Project. And after that, the three of us decided to do some trio gigs. And then we really liked it and stayed together as long as we could. But we started having some conversations about that. I actually was the one probably that shied away from all that because I wasn't trying to bring attention to us because we were women. Right. And I didn't really feel anything different. I didn't think. They, Esperanza and Jerry, talked about kind of in a weird way, they felt like they could, how do I say it? I'm trying to paraphrase. They were basically saying that there was a trust and something that allowed them to let their hair down and just be without feeling judged. And I'm thinking, I'm looking at them like, wow, really you feel judged? And I think I wasn't relating because any feelings like that that came up for me, I would squash. So when they start talking about that, you know, I might start, you know, reading or something, I don't know, because I didn't feel like I had anything really to contribute to that conversation. And now that I look back at it, I feel differently, and I start to think, well, what, you know, if I didn't have that armor that I'm so used to having, what would have been different? So now those are the questions that I'm asking myself. You know, how would my playing, my musicality, everything be different if I hadn't had to, you know, deal with that armor that they were saying that they were happy that they didn't have to have in the trio?
I remember after Jerry passed, you and Esperanza kept the trio week that you had at the Vanguard and played with some other musicians. And when you played Jerry's tune that's in this book, Unconditional Love, it was sort of like a prayer. It was just really intense. Could we play a little bit of Jerry Allen's Unconditional Love? This is Jerry's version when she put it out.
Thank you.
You know, someone just in my, Facebook feed, somebody just posted an old picture of Jerry at the piano, probably at a rehearsal with one of her kids, very young, in a backpack on her back. And it reminded me of stories Betty Carter used to tell, who of course hired Jerry famously, about driving across the country with her kids, which, you know, I'm not trying to read into or glamorize that, but, you know, that's part of the reality of the making that music. Is there anything?
Yeah. I was just going to say, I have that picture in the installation that I did at the Carr Center. One of the pieces that I did was a cork board with pictures of people doing the work that they have to do that's not on stage. Women. They have to, you know.
Wait, what do you call that part? That part, it has a title. Unspoken?
Oh, invisible labor?
Invisible, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Hey, can we go to the second picture? Do you want to say a few words about this installation and what it will lead to? I know it's the first part of something.
Sure. I partnered with the Carr Center. We received a grant of Creative Inflections from Doris Duke. That Rachel received as well. It's interesting because we're both kind of dealing with the gender, from different areas, different places. But I was already working with the Carr Center, so they made sense as a partner for this. And we were talking to a larger institution, but it didn't work out. So we ended up doing a quarter of it. A couple of weeks back it opened. So it's focused on new standards. But I involved a few of the other sections. So the other sections are invisible labor, the female and non-binary gaze, and conversation with Jerry Allen and Mary Lou Williams.
Yeah, can you explain what this is?
That's a quilt that Ramses made, who's also the illustrator of the children's book. And he just did that, on his own. He came up with that, which was, pretty, he was already thinking about Jerry and Mary Lou and putting them together. So I wrote a script. So part of what I'm doing is four films, one for each section. So we have the New Standards documentary that I partnered with Michael Goldman to do. And so Jerry and Mary Lou, I wrote a script, but we have a sound installation where you can hear some actors reading it. And it has a video of Jerry and Mary Lou playing. And then also another sound installation that has oral histories, excerpts of oral histories from Will Hardin Armstrong, Melba Liston, Maxine Sullivan, and Alberta Hunter. And I think that's my favorite part of the installation, because it was just a trip to go through, hours and hours of them talking and pulling out little vignettes about what they had to say. And Melba Liston, something that just blew my mind and just made me really sick was Melba Liston talked about how she was repeatedly raped on the road with these bands that she was in until she got old enough where they weren't interested anymore. Mm-hmm. And I mean, she said it like it was just part of, what you had to deal with if you're gonna be, a woman instrumentalist, in Dizzy Gillespie's big band or whoever else's big band. It was really, and I'm not divulging something that she, she said it's in an oral history at UCLA. So I got permission from Rutgers and UCLA and Tulane to do this piece with these excerpts. So there's a lot of different things. Like we have other jazz artists that are doing a multidisciplinary work. We have Cecile McClarnon-Salvant. She had three pieces. Carmen Lundy, they had two sculptures. I don't know if you have pictures of all those. I know I sent you a bunch of pictures. I don't know what you put in there.
You can move forward a couple of pictures, and we'll see what goes on. Well, here's another one of the quilts.
And then, oh, there's a sculpture. That's
yeah. Go back to that one you just had. The one you just had. Yeah, that.
Yeah, that's a 7-foot sculpture that Carmen Lundy made. And and then to the left of that is this kiosk where you can flip through new standards. So it's another kind of sound installation where you can hear the songs and look at the sheet music and read about each of the 101 women in the book. But anyway.
And then there's the question.
I'm sorry. Oh, yeah.
And there's the question.
Yeah.
Which.
Yeah, there's a lot of very large digital art as well. But yeah, it was a really great experience for me to do this. I even had like Liz Wright. We commissioned her to make a recipe because she has a cafe, and Jasmia Horn. I had her imagine dressing Ella Fitzgerald, and she made a beautiful dress.
And for her. I mean, you told that story about Melba. You know, I sat right here years and years ago with Randy Weston, and he was talking about how what I think was his greatest achievement, Uhuru Africa, and how that couldn't have happened, wouldn't have been realized without Melba, and what Melba brought to that, like that, you know, that piece with Jerry and Mary Lou and what you were talking about. I mean, the histories get so deep because, of course, Jerry was one of the people who played and revived interest in Mary Lou's music. Her playing of her recording of the Zodiac Suite is pretty amazing. And then Jerry created that piece, that theater piece, right? Which I guess kind of maybe what you're doing is almost a continuation of that.
Yeah, I mean, I never saw the theater piece. But yeah, I played some of those arrangements that Jerry did. I did an arrangement that she played as well of one of Mary Lou's Zodiac pieces. So we, you know, had a few occasions where we played Mary Lou's music together. And because of her connection and work with Mary Lou, it felt like a natural thing to, because I don't believe they met. So I wrote an imagined conversation between them as if they were kind of meeting in the spirit world.
Okay, so maybe we'll hear some of Kiana's music, and we have a piece, Sweet Recall. Do you want to say anything about it first, or should we just hear it?
Yeah, this is a song that I'm currently working on. I hope to release it soon and record it, but right now you're going to hear like a demo version, and it features my friend Aaron Stokes on cello. So I also compose and write parts for other instruments, and I got to do that with this song, so that's all I have to say.
Let's hear some of that.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
Now, is that something you wrote during this past year while doing this program, or is it an earlier piece or something you've been working on for a while?
Yeah, it's been something I've been working on for a while. It's been like developing over the past 2 years. Most of my musician journey or just career has been like mostly as a side person, like playing for people. Mm-hmm. And about 2 years ago now, I started composing. Like during the pandemic, you know, having all that free time and allowed me to really, you know, focus on music that I wanted to make. So, yeah, that's an original composition that I've been working on for about 2 years now, and scheduled to release in the next year soon. Yeah.
So when it comes out, you can come back and we can do a whole different kind of event.
Yeah.
I know in this program you've been involved in through this year, you're working with, on the one hand, Liz Wright, the great vocalist, and on the other hand, the great guitarist Brandon Ross. Can you talk a little bit just about how you've worked together and what you've gained from that exposure and that association?
Definitely. So for Liz Wright, I met her about 4 or 5 years ago now. I was a freshman at Berklee College of Music, and Terri Lyne, I believe, was were you hosting the festival or like you?
Mm-hmm. I was artistic director.
Artistic director, right? Yeah, and I was invited and asked to play with Liz Wright when she was there to perform at the festival, and so that was my first time meeting her and. We just seemed to hit it off really well, and now 4 years later, here she is mentoring me, so it felt like a full circle moment just to return to her and work with her. And she's just, she's amazing. She's gracious and humble, and there's so much that I learned from her that's not necessarily about the music, like the sort of technical and logistical side of music. I learned more about, you know, things that you can also apply to life and in spirituality, learning how to trust yourself and be comfortable within your body, because a lot of what we do involves our body, and it's mm-hmm. important to, you know, make sure that we maintain balance within ourselves when we play, which involves breathing and, you know, stretching and all those things. And she helped me to just remember that. And it's kind of the same with Brandon Ross too. His approach to music is also more spiritual. We get together mm-hmm. and we discuss things about intention and how we want to show up in the music and what we're trying to say. And that's been really insightful, just to have mentors who aren't focused only on the playing aspect, which is important, like facility and technicality, but you know, your mindset to music is also just as important, and how you approach it and what your intentions are. You know, are you trying to just play for yourself, or are you trying to, you know, connect to the audience? So it's good to know what your intentions are before you play, and just share your vulnerability with people. So it's been great having those reminders from them.
And Matthew Garrison, too.
Garrison, who I'm seeing tomorrow. So, we just started getting together recently. This is going to be our third meeting tomorrow. And Matt is just great, too. He's just talented and so much knowledge that I've been learning from him, just about business and just being a kind human being. Like, a lot of music, so much preparation goes into music, and we spend more time, like the time that we actually play is usually like the smallest amount of time that you're actually involving and interacting with, you know, people and musicians. So it's important to build those relationships on and off the stage. So, you know, that's just been a lot of my the lessons that I've been learning.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Matthew Garrison, who's about to open the next iteration of his Shapeshifter Club, this time in Park Slope, Brooklyn. Please, everyone should come there once it does open. So, you know, when we talk about the kinds of issues we've talked about, it's often, you know, there are reality checks of, are things changing? Have things changed? Is it different? So I'm curious just to ask the three of you, and especially Terri Lyne, in the 4 years you've been doing what you're doing at Berklee, are things changing in terms of the issues we're talking about? Is there a shift in the ground?
I mean, I'm always an optimist, first of all, but I'm feeling like I'm totally encouraged, yeah. I mean, because I feel like a lot of people just didn't notice for some reason. I mean, I was one of them. Just didn't notice that work needs to be done, but it's really not that difficult. You know, the work itself is really not that difficult. So people just have to do the right thing. And so people ask me all the time, what should I do or something like that? And I'm like, you already know what to do. You know, just do what you know is right. I mean, every book, philosophy book, Bibles, and everything else, you know, basically teaches you to treat other people the way you want to be treated. So if we start there, and if you care about the music and you want it to reach its full potential, that will never happen until there's more equity. So it seems pretty simple, actually. So I think a lot of people just needed to, I can't say be reminded, because everybody, you know, grew up thinking that this is how it is, or this is what it's supposed to be, because this is how it is, this is how it's been, this is what I've seen my whole life. And, you just point out that, no, this is actually, you know, not right. And then it seems like people start to think, yeah, that's right, and I don't want to, you know, because I think most musicians think they're progressive. Yeah. So I think they don't want to be on the wrong side. You know what I mean? I mean, that's what I'm feeling. But people aren't going to tell me that, no, you're wrong. You know, like, no, who's going to say that? No, we want to keep it this way. You know, so of course I'm encouraged, because I'm hearing nothing but positive things, and I'm seeing things, you know. I mean, I remember just feeling super encouraged when Christian McBride hired Nicole Glover and Savannah Harris to play with him. And I'm like, this is, you know, these are the, you know, some of the strides that some of the more mainstream artists need to do, because you see more women playing, I think, in less of the mainstream areas, you know, whatever you want to call it, contemporary improvisation.
Right.
And then, of course, in, I think, in R&B and in other areas, you know, and definitely in classical music. So I think kind of this celebrated jazz tradition everybody's, you know, holding on to has to just really get that together, because it was such a progressive community during the civil rights era. So, but even in the civil rights era, there were problems with misogyny and sexism within that movement. So those are the things that kept happening, you know, through our culture and other areas.
Marta, in your 10 years here, has it seemed like there's been a change afoot in terms of the things we're talking about?
Yeah, I mean, I'm like Terri, I'm also optimistic always, but yeah, I think so. I see, first of all, I see more like in the younger generations, I see like way more presence of like woman. It's like I see it's more equal. There are like way more women, like in people in their 20s, early 20s, there are like way more women. Also just the fact that people is more aware, that people is like asking, what should I do? And people is being more aware that for many years, nobody even like thought, oh, that should change, you know? And now people is like, oh, that should change. And most of the people, I mean, I'm the same. They're not gonna tell me because I'm a woman, but I feel like people wanna change and want the thing to be, and they're thinking more of hiring women, so having like, you know, I think so.
I mean, when I talked to you, Terri Lyne, a while back, you said something that I thought was really powerful, and I'm gonna mangle it by paraphrasing it, but But that, you know, there are the levels at which, okay, you're advocating for equity and against discrimination and against even, you know, abuse and against the limitations of misogyny, but also that the consciousness and the transformation that you're talking about will nurture this art form for all players, regardless of gender, right? Is that?
Yeah, of course.
I mean, you say of course, but I don't know that that occurs to all people, even if they understand it once they hear it.
Well, I mean, you have, you know, 50% of, you know, the gender population not included, you know, in essence. I mean, you know, a little bit here and there sprinkled, in creating, you know, an art form. So it could only mean that the art form itself has not fully seen what it can be when you have only certain people creating it. I mean, studies have proven that in other areas, so why would music or jazz be any different unless it's men's music?
Right.
Mm-hmm. If it's men's music, then okay. I mean, there are certain people that believe that, like Abby Lincoln, she believed that too. You know, she told me herself.
Yeah.
You know, that, you know, men play the music and women sing it. So there's
she said that, and then again, she's in this book, and she created a body of music that is singular, and from her experience, and I've talked to people who are in her band, she was like, here, we're going to march across this field, let me tell you how it's going to be done.
But all I'm pointing out is that she wouldn't hire a woman because she believed that.
Huh.
So my point here is only that, and I didn't fault her, you know, I've done Abby Lincoln tributes, but my point is we participate,
right.
Women participate without even really thinking about it, really not intentionally, but we participate in this kind of whatever, sexism or whatever. Yeah, patriarchy, thank you. But yeah, we participate in cultivating and keeping a hold of this kind of patriarchal thought about this, about the music, without, as I said, without even knowing it. So I think it's, you know, we're talking a lot these days about harm and all of those things, and basically I think we all have to recognize when it comes to not just this, but I mean race, gender, all of these things, that we do create harm. And I think that we have to kind of commit to trying to create less harm. You know what I mean? Because if you have a whole system, I mean, that's why I don't get upset with you know, male colleagues that aren't there yet, because they're just kind of reflecting a system that they were, you know, brought up in, that everything told them that this was okay.
Right.
So then I get upset when you tell them, you know, you sit down and have a conversation and say, this is not okay, you see why? They say yes, and then they keep doing the same thing. Then that's when you get upset. But just because it's the way, you know, it is, I don't get upset because I don't think it's been intentional on their part, for the most part, you know.
I want to open, while we have some time left, open it up to questions or just statements that continue our conversation. I want to welcome anyone who wants to offer something or ask a question. You can just, we're a small enough group where you can just, all right, go ahead.
Terri, how are you?
Good. Damon, oh my God!
The masks hide.
Oh my God!
Well, we went
to college together. I haven't seen him in a while.
I grew up in a female-dominated household, so I always knew my place. So I have, I have a funny story. Terri, you know, our first year at Berklee, when I heard Sydney Blackman play. For those of you who don't know Sydney, she was drumming through stars in her real big claim to fame, was playing with Lenny Kravitz. And when I heard her play, I called my mom and said, I don't like it here. I want to come home. And my mom said to stay. But my question to you is, do you think the younger musicians male musicians are getting the message that you all are trying to send?
I mean, I think so with the people, the community that I see at Berklee, but it's a small group, but it still, you know, makes me optimistic. If I have, you know, 25 young men that are fighting to get in our institute of 50 people, that makes me, yeah, optimistic in a way, you know, but there's a lot more young men at Berklee, but there, but jazz, the jazz community is kind of still small at Berklee, so that's a good, you know, good chunk, actually. But as far as if it's the message is pervasive in the entire community, I don't know how to answer that. I can't really think about that. All I can do is continue to do the work. I know that. I mean, I'm like I know that the work that I'm doing is being accessible to people. You know what I mean? So if they don't pay attention, I can't, you know, really do anything about that. I know that my mentors and the older generation, I think when people get older, they start thinking about it. I mean, you shouldn't have to have a daughter, you know, or a wife for you to think about these things. But sometimes that's what happens. So Wayne Shorter, he was doing gender justice before there was a term for it. You know, always, you know, hiring women, but he's a very progressive person, following the lead of science fiction and all those kinds of things, right? So, I mean, the hippest players seem to, you know, think about it. I mean, even, you know, as problematic as Miles Davis was with some of these things, he still, you know, hired at least one woman, you know what I mean? And I don't think it was really an effort to be fashionable. I think it was really an effort to open things up. You know what I mean? So whoever's not paying attention to that, I kind of feel bad for them, because I feel like if you don't get on board with progressive movements, then you get left behind. And do you really want to be there? So, I mean, it's funny, you know what I mean? It's kind of a funny thing. I have young men that will come into the class and, you know, they say, you know, if it's a young white kid, he'll say, you know, oh, yeah, from my place of privilege, and start, you know, talking kind of like that. And I realize he doesn't, you know, it's an effort, but he doesn't really understand even that, because he's talking to me like, like I'm privileged. You know what I mean? He don't even know how to play yet. And he's telling me how privileged he is. So it's like so much work, you know, that has to be done. But when you get your butt kicked by a woman, I think you can't not pay attention. Or it's just a choice not to. And those are the people that I'm not concerned with. You know what I mean? Because I don't know what kind of music are they even making. I don't know if I'm making sense, but
I remember when I was writing about Jerry Allen, the band director from her school in Detroit said, yeah, Jerry used to take a lot of shit, so what I did was I had her compose a piece for them to play, and then no one gave her any more shit. Since you mentioned Wayne, in addition to New Standards Volume 1 that you should hear, in addition to Marta's album, Spanish American Art Museum, which is wonderful and you should hear, in addition to Kiana's album next year that you will hear and you should hear, there's another great album that's Wayne Shorter, Terri Lyne Carrington, Esperanza Spalding, and the pianist Leo Genovese, and originally, had she not gotten ill, would have been Jerry Allen, but live at the Detroit Jazz Festival, which is just a remarkable recording. And yeah, when I asked Wayne about, hey, how come, you know, you seem to be way, you had an interest in working with female musicians. Yeah, what he said was, well, in science fiction, the women and the children are the ones who make the discoveries and the ones who lead the way. And if you know anything about Wayne and his interests, he meant that very deeply. Any other questions, statements of wisdom? Go ahead.
Hi, how are you? I just wanted to say I appreciate all you boss-ass jazz musicians. it's being led by Justice Thomas. Making a statement, he has no idea what diversity even means. And with Amy Barrett saying that when the civil rights movement started, there should be an import, regardless of what is actually happening in our society. Because I know in my society as a geoscientist, we are fearful that it's going to give a whole bunch of people the permission to say, everything is fine, we don't have to do anything else about equity, diversity, justice, nothing. How do you think that's going to impact the jazz industry?
I mean, I'm trying to wrap my brain around your question. How do I think what's happening in the Supreme Court is going to impact the jazz industry?
Well, they're getting ready to, it's being brought to the Supreme Court to undo affirmative action.
Right.
And other civil rights initiatives. And their argument is that there should be an endpoint to it, that everything is fine.
Oh, I see what you're saying, okay. Okay, so how do I relate that to what we're doing? I mean, first of all, I always think about like the auditions and things like that that people want to do that are blind. And I don't believe in blind auditions. To me, that's related, you know, in a way with affirmative action because nothing was blind before the audition. So I feel like if you're going to, you know, make an impact, you have to be conscious about equity and diversity and, you know, all of those things. So it's already kind of in the jazz community in that way, with people wanting to think that blind auditions are a good thing. So, because that's saying the same thing, like that everything is fine, everybody is equal, so we can have blind auditions. So I'm saying no, I don't agree with that. It's not equal, and we still need to be very conscious and intentional about making these changes. So yeah, I mean, I don't think affirmative action should go away. I don't think that, we would like to think that, you know, things have gotten better, but, you know, we would like to think it would be, you know, it's utopic if we could, like, not look at these things. But, you know, I have a program at Berklee, a summer program that gives 16 scholarships every summer. And I'm always, but you have to be like, you're in high school, but you have to be really better than most average Berklee college student to get this scholarship. And then the people that get this scholarship are earmarked for a scholarship. A lot of them get full scholarships, presidential scholarships, if they get into my program. And every year, it's difficult because all of the audition process and what they send me is mostly white guys. And a few women sprinkled in, very few African Americans. So I then have to really go on a hunt to try to, like, rectify this, because I can't in good consciousness give 16 scholarships to just white guys. Yeah, to white guys. And that's what's presented to me, you know, every year, because of this merit system, in, you know, that all these jazz institutions, you know, educational institutions have. And so that's how I'm looking at what you're saying. It's how, like, for instance, like a university like North Texas State, they win all the big band, you know, competitions, and they're all white guys. So, like, they were trying to do something, you know, with diversity. And they invited me and Tia Fuller, Linda Mahan Oh, Chris Davis. They invited us all to come at the same time. So they took a week and spent a lot of money and took a week to bring us there. And, you know, so I'm saying that bringing us here for a week isn't, you know, so I just tried to beat them up the whole time I was there. But, I mean, bringing us here for a week is not going to solve your problem. So the guy was saying, you know, the school depends on these bands winning these competitions, like kind of like the football team. And that's another problem, you know, jazz, music, jazz, it's not sports. But they, you know, so I'm saying, well, the problem is how you, the merit system that you use to judge how good these players are. And it's the same problem with, you know, the system Berklee uses and every institution. So they value certain things like technique and so forth, reading, you know, precision, and the people that didn't have the head start develop those things sometimes maybe a little bit later. They don't have the same, support through elementary, middle school, high school. So every year I'm finding people with potential that, I just believe, can get there. And miraculously, every year it happens. Whether they go to Berklee or not, I've seen them get scholarships to other colleges as well. And so my fight with the auditions and basically the audition teams, I can't think of the right word, but this department at the college, my fight with them is the system that they're judging, people on, because they're not judging them on the things that made the music what it is in the first place, like how well they play the blues, their rhythmic time feel, in these kinds of things. So, I mean, that's kind of how I'm relating with what you're saying. I mean, that fight is other shows up in other areas as well. And, I'm just dealing with my microcosm of jazz, but it's all definitely all related. And it's the same, it's the same arguments that we're having in jazz education.
If I may, I just want to seize on that question you asked, which is kind of a little afield, but not afield at all, partly because it relates to a lot of stuff I think and write about, and to this place. So this guy, Clarence Thomas, and Scalia, and Alito, who also wanted to take away a woman's right to choose, on the one hand, there's this very old game. Take everything you fought 30 or 40 or 50 years for, pull the rug back, now you can spend 30 or 40, 50 years fighting for the very same thing. But this is deeper. This is deeper. So there are very trite, there's very trite stuff bandied about jazz and Americanness and democracy and the Constitution. But it's actually really deep. This museum creates an ongoing conversation about just how deep that is. These guys, Clarence Thomas, they use this word originalism. And what they mean is this strange, perverse fundamentalism that says the Constitution is meant to be read and interpreted only as the white, wealthy males who created it in the year they created it, when there were in their stuff they are defending, that is a year when a woman couldn't vote or was considered property. But they're saying that, now forget about if you had amendments, how could you even have amendments if that were true? It doesn't make logical sense. But it's, to me, I really do believe that the music that you make, the music Wayne Shorter makes, what this museum is about, is more than just a cheap metaphor. It's the antidote to fundamentalism. It says you have a text, the text is really important, but it's never, it's always mutable, it's always in subject, and so that stuff is, to me, I'm not so interested in, well, how will it affect the, I'm more interested in how can jazz speak to that. Mm-hmm. To me, when children or adults learn about this music and experience it and hear how these musicians work, when I interview them year after year, there is no way that you could hold that originalism thought in your head. This is not just a uniquely American art form, it is, but it's also, it's literally the acting out of the principle that these guys are degrading. So, this is a very dangerous fundamentalism. And we know that when people try to apply dangerous fundamentalisms to jazz, it gets destroyed. That's all I'm gonna say, but just, you clearly touched a nerve. is there anyone wanna just have a last word about all of this before we have to wrap it up? Is there anything else we should say and haven't said? And that includes you people. If not, it's time to stop. The only thing I like more than this is listening to music, but I love being able to talk about and, really the culture to me is a conversation. So please continue this conversation wherever you're going to go, wherever you're going to see, but please help me thank Terri Lyne Carrington, Marcus Sanchez, and Kiana Hutchinson for everything. And come back here, bring your friends, and believe me, there's more stuff we got to talk about, so I will be inviting you back for this stuff too.